turn my way. Looks like you're guilty. Now what do you say?
Oh yes,
I spoke up, Your Honor. I have no defense, but that's when mercy walked in.
In these movies, you know, and stuff like that. But
It was right along with what the word is, what God says. And I won't touch anything or tell anybody anything unless it comes from the word of God. The Lord just gave me that honor to preach Jesus Christ and Him crucified. And that's what I want to be able to do. I do not want to substitute for anything. I know Brother Ellsworth preaches on this subject. Brother Pastor Brown preaches on this subject. And they each have their own interpretation according to the word. But I have my interpretation too, but it's all according to the word. So sometimes somebody hears it from one person, but they understand it better from another. So
amen.
Whether you know anything tonight, maybe you might not understand one thing I said, but I'm going to give it all I got to do with bless the Holy Spirit. First of all, Father, I come to you in the precious name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. I give you all the glory and I give you all the praise. I give you all what I have within me that I can present the words that you want presented tonight to the church. Father, I know that these are stories out of your word, but how they pertain to today, the things of today. We take them and relate them, Lord, to what goes on now. So, Father, I give you the praise and the glory and all. And the Holy Spirit, I ask you to touch my lips, that I anoint me, Lord, as I bring forth your words. And we give you the praise and glory for it all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
The story of this man and his wife, this is all about Ananias and Sapphira. The story of man and wife was placed here in graphic detail in the Bible. It's been put in there for a reason. Because it's a Holy Spirit warning. It's a warning for us. And instantly proclaims that the conception of sin and the deception of being carried out. Oh, we can all sin, you know, we can all think of sin, but do we go ahead and carry it out? That's just one thing that so Ananias and Sapphira, I can't pronounce her name right, but I'll get it. Sapphira did. They knew what they did was wrong with sin. And they went and carried it out. It's a detailed plan with a very wide application. It was done with a certain purpose in mind. Their purpose in mind was greed. Their purpose in mind was to hold on to something they shouldn't give. The story tells us that Peter, after receiving the Holy Spirit, he was given the gifts of the word of knowledge. So remember that when he was given the word of knowledge. In Acts, fourth chapter, if you want to follow me along, before I get into the fifth chapter of Acts, it's time to take verses 32 to 34 in Acts, chapter 4, verse 32 to 34. And the multitude of them that believed were of one heart, and they were on one heart and one soul. Neither said any of them they ought of the things which he possessed was his own. But they had, everybody there had everything in common. Now, as I was watching this movie last night, people all had the same thing over here. Everybody carried whatever they had. It was the same as somebody else had. Some were rich, some had property, some had other things, but this, everything was common. Now, we have a lot of things in common, but yet we have a lot of things that aren't in common. We have more. We have a moral abundance. You know, the Bible says that in John, it says that above all, I wish you would prosper and be in health. But a lot of us prosper more than others. So we have to, but we got to be careful. We got to be careful with what we have. We don't want to get too much stuff that it takes us away from God and from what His work is for us to do. And with great power, verse 33, gave the apostles witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. And a great grace was upon them all. They got to see Jesus Christ after he was raised from the dead. Verse 34 says, neither was there any among them that lacked. Everybody, they were satisfied with what they had. For as many as were possessed of the land or houses sold them and brought them with the price of the things that were sold. Because Peter asked them to bring their, in other words, I call it tithes, but he calls it possessions, which whatever they had, they brought, and they gave it to the they gave it so they can build up the ministry of Christ, build up God's what He wanted Peter to do, build up the ministry. So in Acts, the fifth chapter, I'm going to go over to Acts, fifth chapter now, and go into the story a little bit. Acts 5, verse 1. But a certain man named Ananias, with Sapphira, his wife, sold a possession. They sold some land. Everybody else who had land, they sold land and everything else like that. And because a possession means they had the ownership and priorityship and control and keeping care of and hold a title of guardianship. This is what possession means. They had this. And they kept back part of the price for what they sold. They sold their land for money. And his wife was privy to this. And she was all-knowing what they did. To it, and brought a certain part and laid it at the apostles' feet. Now, they brought this to in the story I was watching last night. I watched how they did it, but the Bible tells it differently, and I want to make sure we get it the right way. They knew what they were doing, so they had a part up. They had a part in it. Look at Acts, which I just read, and I was going to talk about. And they brought a certain part of it and laid it at the apostles' feet. But Peter, being filled with the Holy Ghost, which he was, said, Ananias, why hast thou Satan filled the heart to lie to the Holy Ghost and to keep back part of the price of the land? How did Peter know this? I imagine Ananias was wondering, well, how do you know what I did? And in the movie, they showed Ananias and Sapphira selling their land and then taking part of the money and putting it in a block wall so we're sealing it up and a part of it, but they both knew what they were doing. They knew what they were doing. So Peter, verse 4, it says, while it remained, was it not, he was asking Ananias, while it remained, was it not thy own? And after it was sold, was it not thy own power? Why hast thou conceived this thing in thy heart? Well, what thing are we talking about? We're talking about a lie. Thou hast not lied unto men, but unto God. Now, I've looked over this, and I've thought about it, and after watching the movie, and showing how they build it up, you know. Ananias lied directly to the Holy Ghost. Because Peter knew that he sold the land for more money. Because he said, while it remained, was it not thy own? And after it was sold, didn't you have the possession of what you had? So in verse 5 it says, and then Ananias, hearing these words, fell down and gave up the ghost. Amen. Died. And a great fear came over all of them that heard of these things. Now in this movie, it showed the Ananias standing up there telling him, yeah, this is all I gave. I mean, all I got. But he was lying about it. But it showed him blood coming out of his ears and his nose and his mouth and everything in his eyes. But when he lied to the Holy Spirit and Peter knew about it, he dropped dead like that. There was no bleeding and prolonging of life and everything else. I believe that he said it, it was done. He lied. And he dropped. Because it says in verse 5, and Ananias, hearing these words, fell down and gave up the ghost. And great fear. Now, the fear was because of the people that he was leading. Peter was leading in. The fear came upon them as they said, oh, if you're going to get this close to God and be like that, I'm afraid to do anything. I'm going to drop over dead. That's what they feared. Feared that they were going to lose their life if they did anything wrong. Exactly. Which sometimes, in some of the churches we have today, not this church, but there are so many people in this church that are lying to their God and lying to the Holy Ghost. Uh-huh. It doesn't mean that they might drop over instantly, but they're prolonging their life. They're shortening their lifespan.
Yes.
When you start lying to God, yes, and start doing, you know, being living that kind of a life, you're just shortening your own life. Mm. And the young man arose, wound up, and carried him out and buried him. Verse 6. Now, The reason Peter knew these things is because if we go back to Acts 2, verses 1 through 8, it tells us that how Peter knew these things, because he had a gift. And if you read Acts 2, verse 1 through 8, it says, "And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all in one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound. What was that? Hear that? Did you feel anything? The Bible says a sound. Suddenly there came a sound from heaven as a rush and mighty wind." Now, in the movies, they show a big windstorm coming up and everything else like that, but no. The Bible says there was a sound of a mighty rushing wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues, in other words, divided, separated, like as a fire, and it sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues, as the Spirit gave them utterance. And there was a dwelling at Jerusalem, Jews, devout men, out of every nation under heaven. In verse 6 says, "Now when there was noise abroad, the multitudes came together and were confounded, because that they were puzzled, because that every man heard them speak in their own language. And they were all amazed and marveled, saying one to another, Behold, aren't not these which speak Galileans? And how here we hear every man in our own tongue, wherein we were born." When the disciples were filled with the Holy Spirit and they began speaking in these other languages, I believe every one of them had the gift of knowledge. Because Peter used that knowledge when he was talking to Ananias. Now going back to the story about Ananias, about a 3-hour period, Sapphira was not with Ananias at the time the question was asked. She was summoned. In verse 7 it says, "And it came about the space of 3 hours after, when his wife, not knowing what was done, came in." She already knew what to say because they already planned what they were going to do, what they were going to say. "And Peter, knowing," because he had the gift of knowledge, "answered her, Tell me whether you sold the land for so much." He asked her the question. She could have said, changed her mind, but she didn't. And she said, "Yes, for so much." Well, then Peter said unto her, "How is it that you have agreed together to tempt the Spirit of the Lord?" We don't want to tempt the Spirit of God. So how many people today? I even stop and have to correct myself sometimes. I say, "Oh no, Lord, I'm not going to push it. I don't want to tempt God for anything. I know when I was down on my back and everything else like that, when I thought of many things, and I said, no, Lord, I'm not tempting. Just your will be done. Yes. Your will." Right. Sometimes we go through trials and tribulations that we think, you know, why did I have to go through that? Did I sin? Was it sin that caused me to have that problem? We're human beings. We get old. Some of us get older than others, but we're human. So I'm not 21 years old. I can't lift the things I used to lift, or how to lift them. And as we get older, we have to learn how to live differently.
Yes.
Start using our legs for lifting instead of just bending over and picking something up.
Yes.
I used to do a lot of that when I was younger, and that's why the Lord was teaching me in this food ministry. Food ministry is great. I love the food ministry. A lot of it is a lot of light work, but there are heavy boxes at times. Mm-hmm. So I've learned how to handle that. So I just praise God for that healing He gave me. So anyway, she fell down straightway and died. I mean, and so he told her. He said, "The young men that carried out your husband, their feet are at the door. They're coming here to carry you out, to bury her by her husband." The 11th verse says, "And great fear came upon all the church and upon as many as heard these things," because they were afraid. They were afraid they were going to, if they did something wrong. And you know what? I think some churches today should have the fear of the Lord put into them to be careful of what they do or say. because we're living in the last days, and things are getting so easy to fall to the wayside, you know, and say the wrong thing to somebody, and we got to be careful on what we say. In verse 12, it says, "And the hands of the apostles, and by the hands of the apostles, were many signs, wonders wrought among the people, and they were all with one accord in Solomon's porch." Who were these people that were in Solomon's courts? The apostles. Well, there was Peter, James, John, Andrew, Bartholomew, James, the younger, Judas, Jude, Matthew, Philip, Simon, and Thomas. They were all filled with the Holy Spirit. But not only them, there was women in that upper room at that day of Pentecost.
That's right.
Mary was there. She was filled with the Holy Spirit. So they were all filled. Verse 13 says, And the rest, they were angry. No man joined himself to them, but people magnified them. And the believers were the more, And believers were the more added to the Lord, multitudes, both men and women. Multitudes, meaning a large number. Inasmuch that they brought forth the sick into the streets and laid them on their beds and couches, that at least the shadow, man, I thought about that after I read the shadow of Peter, just by passing, might overthrow them. What a gift we could have. What a gift if we could get that close to God's calling. And somebody that's sick is, you walk by them and they instantly get healed. Wow, that's a gift. That's a gift to churches. We should be seeking very, very hard today. Amen. Seeking that gift of healing. You know, the gift of healing is not just somebody coming up, laying hands on somebody and praying for them. That's not just a gift of healing. Pastor talked about it the other day. Prayer. Pray for someone that they might be healed. Just by praying for them. And they get healed. Well, I got healed the other day. What happened? You know, somebody must have been praying for me. Well, that church prayed for me. Something did happen here. Amen. You know, we talk about miracles. Well, here's a miracle. Amen. But by praying for one another, by praying, earnest prayer we need for this church. We need earnest prayer so this church can grow. And if we pray for this town, this is Hesperia, if we earnestly pray for Hesperia, we'll see people coming in. I really believe that. But that gift of passing by might overshadow them. What a gift. I'd love to have that gift. I'm sure you would too. There came also multitudes, on the 16th verse, out of the cities round about into Jerusalem, bringing sick folk, and them that were vexed, in other words, tormented, with unclean spirits, and they were all healed. They were every one that was healed, not just one or two or a few. Everyone got healed. Amen? Then the high priest rose up. Now this is they've got mad because of all this healing going on. Then the high priest rose up, and all that they were in with him, which select of the Sadducees, and were filled with indignation. In other words, resentment. They were outraged. They were angered. They were distressed. They were in happiness. They were discontent. They was hurt. It was pain. The Sadducees and the Pharisees, they didn't like what was going on. So, in verse 18, it says, "And they laid their hands on the apostles," which all of them, "and put them in common prison. But, the angel." Now, I believe when they were in prison, I believe they were praising God because they were further on. I'll show you where it was. "But the angel of the Lord, by night, opened the prison doors and brought them out forth and said," told them, "Go, stand and speak in the temple to the people all the words of this life." In other words, be up here telling you what's going on in the world, telling you what's in the word. Pastor Ellsworth preaches what's in the Word. Pastor Brown teaches what's in the Word. So what I'm trying to do right now, go stand and speak in the temple to the people all the words of this life. Verse 21 says, and when they heard that, they entered into the temple early in the morning and taught. But the high priest came and they that were with him and called the council together and all the senate or the senators of the children of Israel and sent them to prison and sent to prison, have them brought. They wanted them to bring them back into the temple to the Sadducees and Pharisees. And they in verse 23 it says, saying, the prison truly found we shut with all safety. In other words, when the temple guards went to the prison, everything was safe. But when they got there, the keeper standing was above the door. But when we had opened, we found nobody in there. How did they get out? Well, verse 19 tells us, but the angel of the Lord opened the prison doors. Mm-hmm. And verse 24 says, now, when the high priest and the captain of the temple and the chief priests heard these things, they doubted of them whereunto this would go. I'm trying to read my own writing down here. They were feeling uncertain about these things. They did not want any of this to get out. They didn't want any of the people to know what was going on. So in verse 25 says, then came one and told him, saying, behold, the men whom we put in prison are standing in the temple and they're teaching. They're in the temple. So in verse 26 it says, then when the captain of the officers and brought them without violence, for they feared of the people, lest they should be stoned. In other words, they went and got the disciples. They brought them back to the Sadducees and the Pharisees. They brought them back to them. But they had to do it nicely so the people that the guards didn't want to be stoned. I showed that, and then I said, well, that was a good part. I didn't understand that as well as I when I read it earlier, but then when I read it now, I said, well, yeah, it's very similar. They were afraid. They were afraid. They didn't want to get caught. They didn't want to get stoned, so they'd done it very privately. And when they had brought them, they sent them before the council and the high priest and asked them. Now, they asked the disciples, saying in verse 28, did not we strictly command you that you should not teach in this name? Talking about Jesus here. And behold, you have filled Jerusalem with your doctrine and intend to bring this man's blood upon us. They already had the blood upon them. They're the ones that had him beaten and crucified. So the blow is already on them. Then Peter and the other apostles answered and said to Sadducees and Pharisees, we ought to obey God rather than man. You know, in our lifetimes, as we're growing up and getting older, and there are things that somebody might want us to do, but we know we ought to know better not to do it. You know, I mean, God, it's just like somebody say, hey, I want you to go out and beat that guy up. Well, that's not what God wants me to do. I can't do it. Well, the law says I want you to do that. Well, no, we have to hold fast to what God's law is. God's law is love. Love one another. That's what God's law is. So they asked him, did we not strictly command you that you should not teach in this name? But Peter, he told them we ought not to obey. We have to obey God rather than man. In verse 30, it tells us that God of our fathers raised up Jesus, whom ye slew and hanged on the tree. He told them. He wasn't afraid to tell them what they did. Verse 31 tells us that him hath God exalted with his right hand to be a prince and a savior, for to give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sin. And verse 32 says, and we, this is Peter talking again, are with his witnesses of these things that so is also the Holy Ghost, whom God has given to them that obey him. In this story, I was watching it earlier, because if you watch the story, it goes on and on about it leads into Peter and John, and goes on further into the story about the Saul on the road to Damascus and on. It's really, really interesting. I'm watching the story as it goes through, but I'm relating it to what the scripture says. Sure, it's Hollywood that builds up a thing, you know. But it's not a bad thing to watch if you know what you're to look for. And by studying the Word of God, you can understand, you know, where their mistakes are. But it's a good thing to watch. Then Peter talking here and with his witness of these things, and he said, so is also the Holy Ghost, who God has given to them to obey him. We have to obey. When they heard that, they were cut to the heart and took counsel to slay them. In other words, the Sadducees and the Pharisees, they got mad. They did not like what they were doing. Then stood there up one in the council, and they showed this last night. There was one of the councilmen come together and told him, says, hey, wait a minute, stop. When they heard that, they were cut to it in their heart and took counsel to slay them. Then stood up this one in the council, a Pharisee named Gamaliel, I guess we pronounce it, G-A-M-A-L-I-E-L, Gamaliel, a doctor of the law, a guy that knew things, he knew what was going on, had a reputation among all the people and commanded to put the apostles for give them a little space. In other words, back off. He was trying to tell them that the things that they were doing, if you just leave them alone, they figured it would just die down. You know, they're just trying to cover up, you know, what God was. God had already had it planned out what was going on. And Peter and John and the other disciples, they just had to carry out what God wanted them to do. Even though the Sadducees didn't want them to do it, they had to do it. So he said, well, give him a little space. In verse 35, and he said unto them, ye men of Israel, take heed to yourselves what ye intend to do as touching these men. Be careful, in other words. For before these days rose up, Theudas, boasting of himself and somebody, to whom the number of men, about 400, joined themselves, who was slain, and all, and the many obeyed him, were scattered abroad. So they thought they could just let Peter, John, and the disciples do what they want to do. Eventually things would die off. You know, well, you know, just leave them alone. Just give them some space. Because they figured that what happened to this other guy, they would just die off, and they couldn't, people would just, you know, just go cold and they quit. But after this man rose up, Judas of Galilee, in that days of the taxing, and drew away much people after him, he also perished, and all, even as many as obeyed him, were dismissed. So they were gone. They were dismissed. Verse 38 says, and now I say unto you, refrain from these men, and let them alone, for the counsel of their works be done. It will come to naught. In other words, it will come to nothing. Just leave them alone. But if they be of God, now this is the part I like here, yeah. But if it be of God, you cannot overthrow it.
That's right.
If it was of God, you can't overthrow it.
Yeah.
Lest happily he be found even to fight against God. I mean, they worshiped God, but they did not worship Jesus Christ, Jesus, because they didn't believe he was the Son of God. Mm-hmm. And I like that part where he said, just it'll come to nothing, yeah, right. But if it be God, you can't not overthrow it. Anything we do, if it's from God, cannot be overthrown. And to him, they agreed, and when they had called the 12 apostles and beaten them, they took them out and beaten them and commanded them that they should not speak in the name of Jesus, and then let them go. Amen. We as Christians today, and all through the world, there's so many Christians today in the world that are being tormented. Some are being beheaded, some are being dismembered, but, you know, being killed. But Paul and his disciples, and Peter, the other 11, they were all beaten, and they were counted worthy to suffer the shame. How many of us would take a somebody come up and say, well, we're going to beat you after death if you don't give up your religion or your Christianity or curse the name of God. How many of us would be willing to take a beating? You know, you stop to think about that. It reminded me of the story of the gentleman that came into a church. He was all skid, but he came into the church with a gun, and he come in and he fired off some shot, but it was blanks. And the people were scared. He came up on the platform. He's standing up on the platform, and he says, "How many of you church believe in Jesus Christ?" And everybody raised their hand. "How many believe you're going to go to heaven?" And they all raised their hand. And he said, "Now, how many of you want to go to heaven today?" And he cocked the gun back. It's shocking, but there are so many churches today that the people are sitting in the pews, and all they are. If Christ was to come tonight, for the next minute, are we all going to be gone? Some of these churches there today, I don't know where they're going. I know where they're going if they're not a true believer. Jesus is coming back for those that are watching and waiting. But how many of us could really stand the beating for Christ? Think about it. I thought about it very hard last night. I even dreamt about it. Oh man, Lord, I can't be. I don't think I could take that kind of beating. I think I'd rather grab my little 22 and shoot myself while they're doing it. Pretty much you're out of misery. But you can't. But you really sit there and think about it sometime. Are we too proud today to do that? Are we Christians, or are we just people? Religious. There's a difference between religion and Christianity. A lot of people are religious, no matter what their religion is. They're religious. But there's very few. The Bible says straight is the gate, and straight is the way, but narrow is the gate, wide is the road. Only few that are going to find it. Are we the few that are going to find it, the church today? Many of our churches today are not going to find it. They're going to fall by the wayside. So during this time, and daily in the temple and every house, the 42nd verse, it says they ceased not to teach and preach. They did not stop. They teach and preach Jesus. They did not stop preaching. They did not stop. We can't stop. We can't stop today. Everything that we do today, we should be preaching the Word of God. Amen. Every word that comes out of our mouth should be blessed with us. Words to encourage somebody. Amen. And we should all have. I've read that was another part of another sermon I was thinking of about the gifts of the Spirit. We all, as born again Christians, filled with the Holy Ghost, we all should have at least that gift of knowledge. And knowledge is nothing but to know past, present, future. And do you want to know past, present, future? 2 Timothy. Study to show thyself a workman. Rightly dividing. We have to do that. Study His Word so we know what to do when the time comes. I had more that I was going to add to it, but I just, I think I already said it. It says in Acts, the second chapter, 1 through 8, it says, when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all in one accord in one place. That we already talked about that. And then I said there was a sound of the rushing wind. People today, I've talked to many, many people today, and they all say, well, the wind blew hard enough to where they scared everybody half to death, you know. But there was no wind. The Bible says the sound. And some of the other versions of the Bible does say it was a real blow feast. But it wasn't. It was just a sound. Just like I did. It's only a sound. But the ones that were ready to receive heard that sound. Not everybody heard that. Just those that were there in the upper room heard that sound. They were all filled with the Holy Ghost. It's new. Today, Ananias And so if I lied to the Holy Spirit, we have to be so careful of what we do and say, because we do not want it to be a lie. Like Pastor Ezra says, and things, God has a special place in hell for those who lie. My grandson sometimes will say something to me, and I said, "Is that, yes, that's not true what you're saying?" I says, "Be careful what you say." And then they had a little song once, a little song a long time ago, when little kids used to be careful what you say, but what you do.
Careful little eyes what you see.
Careful little eyes what you see. Your mouth what you say, and what the ears you hear. Yeah, that was a song. That's an old song. But it's true. We have to also be, we have to be like that. We have to be as, we're his children. We might be old in our ages, but we're still his children. We're heirs, we're joint heirs with him. So we have to really be careful of what we say and how we say it. If we tell somebody something, let it be pertaining to the word. Because then that'll get them to wonder, well, what do you mean by the word? Or what do you mean by this? And then, and if you're gifted in the word, you understand what the word says, you'll automatically know where to go to get to talk about it. People ask you a question, you just, well, here, let's look in the Bible. I'll answer you out of what the Bible says. Not what I say, what the word of God says. And Ananias and Sapphira, they knew. They knew. They had that all built, put in their heart to lie. And it's, I'm telling you, it's easy. It's easy to lie. I know when I was growing up, I was one of the biggest liars there was.
Uh-oh.
I mean, I don't think anybody could outlie me when I was young. I don't know. My mother, whatever my mother said I did, it was wrong. Or my father. But I praise God that he's taught me other things and taught me different ways to live. And by reading the story and watching this movie about Ananias and Sapphira, it brought a realization to me that how unimportant we really are. But he's the most important in our lives, and we have to listen to what he has to say. To do God's will, some of us don't want to do God's will. I felt there's been times that I didn't want to do God's will, and the Lord spanked me for it too. Think the Lord doesn't spank you?
Just that.
He sure does. If you don't do it, that's why I say, if God tells you to do something and you know it's from God and know it's that Spirit talking to you, do it. Do it. That's all I have to say for tonight. I just want you to understand that we have to be careful on how we walk and how we talk. Amen. Do what God wants us to do. Don't be like Ananias and Sapphira. Be truthful to everything we do and say for one another. Most of all, pray for one another. I was in there reading the word today, and the Lord just spoke to me and says, pray for the church. Pray. And we can pray. We don't have to be set out a certain time of day to pray. We can pray anytime we want to pray. How many are filled with the Holy Ghost? How many can speak in tongues? We can pray all day long. Nothing can stop us. We have the power. Where do we find that power? In Luke 16:10, I think it is. 16:10 or 10:16? 10:9. Oh, 10:9. We have that power because God gave it to us. So let's use it. Emma, you dismiss us.
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the Word of God, and we thank you that we'll be able to use this Word, Lord, that we won't be tempted, Lord, to lie and to be truthful, to be honest, Lord. We ask, Father God, that you would just minister to us as we go home, Lord, sending your traveling mercies with us, Lord, to prepare our path and just to continue to speak to each and every one of us, that we would have eyes to see and ears to hear what your Holy Spirit is saying to us. We just thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. I think there's some stuff on the table back there.
Your love.